He says you can't do it by keeping statues, and it won't work. That won't work. You can't do it by looking for signs. That won't work. But then in verse 8 through 10, he tells us how to really find it. He tells us how to receive it, how to appropriate salvation. He says that if you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Are you praying with me? And so he says it's not in statues, it's not in signs, but it really is in surrender. So all Jesus wants you to do is to surrender yourself over to him, and by putting your faith and trust in his finished work on Calvary's cross. He says all you have to do is surrender. That'll work. Just surrender yourself. You can't fix yourself. You can't fix your issues. You can't get off drugs by yourself. You can't get off alcohol by yourself. You can't get off of sexual sins by yourself and alone. All you gotta do is surrender. Jesus will fix it for you. He knows just what to do. Come on, somebody. He'll fix it for you because he's made it available for you. Paul says the salvation is close. You don't have to look for it. You don't have to go on a quest for it. He says it's close. All you've got to do is surrender. And he says you do that in two steps. He says as close as your mouth is to your body. And your mouth is on your body. It's close as your heart is in your body. That's close. He says it's that close to you if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. What are you talking about, preacher? It's a two-step process. He says, first of all, it's with the mouth. He says, confess the Lord Jesus with your mouth. The word confess carries the idea of saying the same thing about something.
Right.
Confession means, in the scripture, it means saying the same thing about something. And the thing that we need to say the same about is Jesus Christ.
Right.
We need to say the same thing about Jesus Christ that God the Father says about Jesus Christ.
Right.
We need to agree with God. Are you praying with me? About everything that God says about Jesus. Well, how do you know what God says about Jesus? It's in the Word. The Word of God, the gospel message tells us everything that we need to confess about Jesus, that we need to agree with about Jesus, is in the Word of God. Well, preacher, hurry up and tell me what I need to confess in order for me to articulate the gospel message of salvation, in order for me to assess my own situation and where I stand. Hurry up and tell me if I'm confessing the right thing, if I'm agreeing with God about the right thing. It's right there in the Word of God. First of all, you need to confess and believe that he was born of a virgin. Because of his virgin birth, he was not born like you and I. He was not born with the seed of the man, but he was born with the seed of the woman and the Holy Ghost. Are y'all praying with me? And so now he does not have a sin nature like ours. So when he died on the cross, he wasn't dying for his own sin, but he was dying for ours. He has a sinless nature. He has a sinless nature, and he was born of a virgin. But the scriptures also tells us that he is Lord of all. The scripture tells us that he is King of kings and Lord of lords. You might not agree with it right now, but the scripture says that in the end, when Jesus comes, every knee shall bow, and every tongue must confess that Jesus is Lord of all. He was born of a virgin. He has a sinless nature. He is Lord of all, of his lordship. But you need to confess and believe his substitutionary death on the cross. Jesus died in our place. He gave his life so that we might inherit eternal life. Not only his substitutionary death, but we need to believe, confess and believe the resurrection bodily from the grave. Jesus wasn't a spirit. He wasn't a ghost, but he was a body that got us out of the grave, never to return to the grave again. He, on the third day morning, he got up with all power in his hands. Are y'all praying with me? Not only the resurrection, but you need to believe with your heart and confess with your mouth the ascension back to glory. After he was here, the Bible says that he ascended on the cloud back to heaven, where he is on the right hand of the Father. You need to believe in his ascension, but you need to believe in his intercessory responsibilities on behalf of believers, because he's on the right hand of the Father as an advocate. Every time we do wrong and somebody accuses us of wrong, Jesus says, I already died. I already shed my blood so that he can be forgiven for all his wrongs. Not only has intercession, but you need to believe and confess his visible return. Because one of these days, Jesus is coming back. I know that. I know that time has gone on since it has for thousands of years. And we are looking for the return of Jesus. And some people think that he's not coming because he has been delayed. But I want you to know that in the right time, in the right era, in the right moment, Jesus is going to crack the sky. And everything as we know it is going to be changed. Are y'all praying with me? He's coming back again. All of these things are essential to salvation. That you believe and agree with God on his virgin birth, his sinless nature, his lordship, his substitutionary death on the cross, his resurrection from the grave, his ascension back into heaven, his intercession on our behalf, and his visible return. And the Bible says that you need all of that to believe all of that. You can't do it like the buffet line. You can't do it like Golden Corral. When you leave this building and you go to eat and you pick some of the things you want, you like the ham and you like the roast beef, but if you don't want no Brussels sprouts, you can't do it like that. When you get to Jesus, you gotta take the whole package. Are y'all praying with me? Amen. Because to reject any of those things is to reject the person and the work of Jesus Christ. I love it when he says that you need to confess it with your mouth. The mouth is required to confess the truth about who Jesus is. That's the first step. You got to agree with God about Jesus. And when we say confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, a lot of people say, well, that's just too simple. But there's a lot behind that confession. There's a lot of agreement behind that confession with our mouths and our belief in our hearts. But not only is there the mouth, he says it's as close as your heart. He says it's in the heart. He said, in the ancient world, I saw the heart as the center of all thought. The ancient world saw the heart. In your chest, it saw it as the house of your will. In other words, you don't do anything unless it comes from the heart. That's how the ancients believed. And they believed that it was the position or the place for the most the center of our being. It is the most center for a person is in the heart. In other words, Paul is saying, so when he said that you got to believe in your heart, he's saying that to be saved, a person must place his absolute trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ. That means with your whole being, with all that you are, you believe that Jesus is who the Bible says he is, and that his work on Calvary's cross is enough for your sins to be forgiven. Are you praying with me? In other words, Paul is saying, to know that you're saved, to know that you know, you have to believe in Jesus Christ with all your heart. Are you praying with me? With all of your mind, with all of your being. And if Jesus has all of that, then nobody else or nothing else has any of it. And so I'm not saved because I'm trusting in Jesus and I'm trying to live right. I'm saved because I'm trusting in Jesus. My living right is just a product of my relationship with the Lord. My righteousness, such as it is a product of already being a child of God. Are y'all praying with me? And so we need to understand, because there are a lot of people who've got that one hand on Christ and another hand holding on to something else. Holding on to something somebody told you that ain't even in the Bible. Are y'all praying with me? That you gotta worship on the right day. If you ain't on the right day worshiping, then you ain't saved. Some people saying that you gotta live right and keep the commandments in order for you to really be saved. But that's too complicated and too technical, because I can't keep the law. So how am I, is my not keeping the law going to help me be saved? The reason why Jesus came is because I couldn't handle the law. Are y'all praying with me? Yeah. It's Jesus alone. And if you're trusting in anything else in addition to Jesus, don't marry nothing else with Jesus. It's Jesus alone. And your commitment has to be to him only. Not what your mama said. Not what grandmama said. Not what big daddy said. None of them matter. It's about what the word says. And the word says we are saved by grace through faith and that not of ourselves. It's the gift of God. If he gave it to me, I'm not working to keep it, and I didn't work to earn it. It's a gift. Are you praying with me? Amen. Amen. And so he says in the heart, salvation is Jesus and putting your faith in him and his finished work on Calvary's cross. But I love it that he doesn't just tell us, you know, how we are saved, but he tells us what we have in salvation. Because there are some promises that Paul relates to us that we receive when we accepted Christ as our Savior. And so as we begin to assess our situation, or whether we've got our trust and our faith really in Christ or not, if we find that we are in Christ and we have put our whole faith in him and nothing else, in him alone, then there are some promises that he gives to us.
Yes, sir.
Verses 11 through 13 says that promises when we come to faith the right way, when we come to God the right way through Christ, we are given some of the promises. And verse 11 says the first promise we're given is assurance. We are reminded that when we trust in Jesus, we will never be disappointed. I'm assured that because of my faith in him, I will never be turned away. I will never hear Jesus say, I don't know you.
Yeah, right.
Amen. When I get before him and I stand before him, he's going to receive me.
All right.
Because I put my faith in him. It's a blessed assurance.
Yes, sir.
That's what the songwriter was talking about when he said, blessed assurance.
Yes.
Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory, divine heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. I don't have nothing else. I didn't earn it. I don't belong here on my own. I didn't do anything for him to love me. He just loved me. That's my story. That's my song. And that's why I don't mind giving him praises. Because I didn't do anything to get here. I was on my way to hell. But Jesus picked me up and turned me around. And that's the promise I have, his assurance. And he will never, ever turn his back on me. Are y'all praying with me?